How you doing, everybody? My name is Kerry Wilson. The show is Off the Mat. This is where we profile martial artists, some famous, some not. And it's not so much about how they kick, punch, or choke, or style, or system. It's more about who are they? What are they like when they're not training? What are their interests, their hobbies? In other words, what do they do when they're off the mat? And we're going to start the show off with an old buddy of mine. This is Dave McNeil.
This. Got a cup on?
No, sir.
I should have asked that before.
Dave's upbeat and positive attitude is his trademark teaching style. A unique disposition, considering the horrific challenges forced upon Dave at a very young age.
And I was orphaned. My brother and I were orphaned at, I was seven, he was five. Our parents were pilots. They were flying to Northern California and had icing problems going back. They crashed, and they actually lived. They were trapped in the plane, and they froze to death. My mother kept a diary. And so there was another couple with them, and we kind of knew what order people died in. But as near as we can figure, they had lasted about a week, and then finally froze to death. So we were taken in by my aunt and uncle. They had two kids about our same age. So from there, I was in the fourth grade, so I was about 10, I guess. And I contracted polio. This is 1950 or so, when I was on what they call forearm crutches. And that's kind of the genesis of where the cane system started.
Additional episodes of Off the Mat include Masters John and Lucy Olivier at their Alpine Training Center for Martial Arts. Both John and Lucy are masters in Reiki. And when they aren't healing their human counterparts, they turn their unique skill set to help out their four-legged friends.
When I first come to treat a horse, I kind of just lightly take my hands around the horse. So it just tells me he's got some lower back things going on. I just set my hands on acupressure points and spots where I feel heat on the body. And so by putting my hand one on top and one below, I'm actually sending the energy from the top into the bottom and going through his whole body.
Off the Mat will also brave the Los Angeles freeway for a trip to downtown Burbank and a visit to the Martial Arts Museum, where the owner and creator spends all of his time off the mat, preserving the memories and memorabilia of our art.
Well, this is an educational, cultural facility, and it enlightens people about the history, the art, and the culture of the martial arts. But this is a place to teach you about each of the countries and the important role martial arts played in that country and how it became part of American history.
Off the Mat profiles individuals from all walks of life, often overcoming insurmountable odds through martial arts.
Weaver, also 10 years old from Colorado. He's working it. Tyler Weaver is your winner.
Karate and martial arts was definitely my thing, so I continued on training and doing it, and now I've been doing it pretty much my whole life. I don't know what it is or how he does it, but if he stays focused, he will accomplish anything he wants. Like, yeah, he's got really good technique, he's got phenomenal tricks, phenomenal kicks, but it's the way he presents it. One of my goals, I guess, is I want to be kind of like a role model or a leader to help other individuals that are also on the spectrum and show them that they can get help, you're not alone on this.
No, you're right. People under the spectrum. They know what that means. I just hate that word. Every time I see it, it's just, I just know idiots around the world are just gonna use it as a weapon against someone.
This man is about to break 20 one-inch bricks with his mind. Chi is an inner strength which draws its power from the mind. The hand or foot is merely an instrument delivering the message. Developing the mind is the ultimate essence of power because the body will do whatever the mind wills. Karate master Victor Hughes is a living example of the power of the mind. You see, Mr. Hughes is 100% disabled. Wounds from three tours of duty in Vietnam left Marine Sergeant Hughes crippled for life.
I had my head blown apart, so I'm
plastic from it. I got hit in the chest, which caused my shoulder to be tore out. That's held together with about a pound and a half of plastic and three screws. Took a round in the leg there, took out 3 inches of bone and part of the artery. Took out the ulnar nerve in this arm and blew it apart. Got bayoneted in the back. A lot of shrapnel all around the rest of my body, so it was pretty bad.
This photo shows Victor in his prime, a muscular, combat-ready Marine. But after 3 years in the hospital, medical specialists predicted a bleak future for this battle-scarred veteran.
They told me that I was just going to be almost a vegetable. Just almost a vegetable.
Before Vietnam, Hughes was a dedicated student of the martial arts, studying with the masters in Japan. From his hospital bed, he called upon his black belt mental discipline to accomplish what the doctor said could not be done.
And I became strong from the inside out, not from the outside in. I trained my mind not to be disabled.
Knock me off! Off! Harder!
Surgical pins and artificial parts prevent Master Hughes from developing the physique of a bodybuilder again. But if you don't think every inch of his frame isn't as solid as a rock, just ask one of these black belts.
Get angry.
You set your opponent up. You make sure you fake and drive in.
Here the students are learning Master Hughes' special blend of karate and common sense. It's called DOCS, D-O-C-S. It stands for defense, offense, and common sense. When he isn't teaching the martial arts, Master Hughes is writing about them. His weekly articles don't pull any punches either.
Well, if I'm going to write the truth, then I'm not going to play politics with you. Because martial arts has no room for politics. And martial artists shouldn't be playing politics. They should be doing one thing, teaching and still learning. You never get high enough that you don't learn. Because once you stop learning, you die.
These American kickboxers have traveled to the land of a thousand smiles to put their skills to task. For 14 days and nights, they're going to train like their Muay Thai counterparts, allowing them to experience what the heart of Muay Thai is all about. At the end of their two-week ordeal, they're going to have the opportunity to find out if they have the guts and skill to enter the ring and go one-on-one against a professional Muay Thai fighter. Like most American fighters, these guys were accustomed to some pretty fancy training digs. For example, at Cheney's Gym in Upland, California, they have spacious training areas covered in mats, dozens of kicking devices, a well-equipped weight room, and a full-size ring, not to mention showers. These luxuries are simply not commonplace in Thailand. There aren't any frills here. In Thailand, they train on a rough cement surface that can shred unconditioned feet in a matter of minutes. They use homemade weights. They shower by splashing water on themselves from a community trough. And the sweat-laden surface of their ring could be best described as one very large petri dish. What began as an adventure of a lifetime for a handful of novice American Muay Thai fighters almost ended in a riot. For more than four decades, Black Belt Magazine has been serving the martial arts community with its coverage of the people, places, and events that shape our sport, and in the process, set a new standard for publishing excellence. In July of 2005, Black Belt set the bar even higher by presenting Black Belt Magazine's first annual Festival of Martial Arts.
Magazine.
The training seminars featured some of the biggest names in martial arts. Onlookers were amazed to see these icons just a few feet away from them giving hands-on instruction in their particular art form.
Okay, relax your shoulder.
No, I
can fight you.
Don't bring it really forward. You just keep watching. Power.
On Friday night, everybody traded in their gis for black ties and got all gussied up for Black Belt's Hall of Fame banquet held at the Globe Theater inside Universal Studio Hollywood. Everyone got the star treatment, complete with a red carpet and paparazzi. The Universal Studio courtyard was transformed into an open-air disco. White belts and grandmasters alike boogie oogie oogie the night away. It was the perfect ending to a perfect day.
Terry, you feel good. How do you look?
Now, see that? Here's our shot. Well, you just stay steady, we'll get the shot. There you go. Got to get down lower. I'm too short. Okay, this is the before and after. Which is before, which is after? Tap, 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 tap. He's the best. He's the man.
Yay, you're the man.
Hi, I'm Terry Wilson. Welcome to Street Combat, Real Stories of the Martial Arts. The individuals featured in this program have one thing in common. They are all martial artists who have had to use their skills and their training in a life or death situation.
I came up to the door, I dropped my keys, and this man stuck a gun in my back. I said, I'm not taking my clothes off, and I kicked him.
When he got within about 3 to 2 feet of me, he decided to swing this metal object towards my head.
During 1975, there was a situation where I had to use my martial arts skills against a guy with a gun.
The most important thing about self-defense, well, if you're a team guy, that's to win at all costs.
Buddy.
Yeah. That confrontation taught me a valuable lesson. Every time I leave a building, or even if I just go for a walk, I'm always very aware of what's going on around me. After all, avoiding a confrontation is the ultimate self-defense. Remember, it's always best to avoid a fight, but if you do have to use your skills in street combat, we want to hear from you. Until next time, I'm Terry Wilson. Stay safe.